Welcome. We welcome you this morning as we gather here online. I'm Marcia Curtis, and I am a retired Unitarian Universalist Community Minister and a member of Beverly Unitarian Church. Oh, it's my pleasure to welcome you here to join us this morning in our virtual worship service. All people are welcome here. We're an inclusive faith. And so whatever life-affirming faith or lack of faith you profess, you are welcome here. Whatever the color of your skin, whatever your level of ability, you are welcome here. Whether you are straight or gay, bisexual or transgender, you are welcome here. It is a delight to have all of you here today.
JC, won't you smile at me? Got a Hosanna, a superstar. Tell the robber to be quiet, we anticipate a riot. This common crown is much too loud. Tell the mob, sing your song, that they are fools and they are wrong, they are they should disperse. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna. JC, you're all right by me, and a Hosanna, a superstar. Why waste your breath moaning at the crowd? Be done to stop the shouting. Every tongue was still, the noise would still continue. The rocks and stone themselves would start to sing. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna. JC, JC, won't you fight for me? Hosanna, Hosanna, hey, superstar.
Our opening words this morning are from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 35. The wilderness and dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and bloom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. Please join me as we say the words for the chalice lighting. The chalice is the symbol of Unitarian Universalists. Life is a gift for which we are grateful. We gather in community to celebrate the glories and mysteries of this great gift.
That I might know your mind. Come, walk and reign with me. Come, walk and reign with me. Come, walk and reign with me. That I might know your mind. And I'll bring you home when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me. Come share a rose with me, and I might know your mind. And I'll bring you home when hope is hard to find. And I'll bring a song of love and a rose in the winter time.
Let us all say our covenant together. Love is the spirit of this church and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Hi, this is my dog Mojo. David's dog Pilot has attended our services and listened to the story a couple of times now, so Mojo said he'd like to meet you and be able to hear the story too. Say hi, Mojo. Say hi. He's a good dog. I want to read you a book called My Heart by Corinne Loyan. This is the very first page, and you can see that the young lady is planting a heart-shaped plant. And here it's grown into a heart, a yellow heart. My heart is a window. My heart is a slide. The window can be closed or opened up wide. Some days it's a stain. You can see how the cat has knocked over the paint. Some days it is cloudy and heavy with rain. Mojo just left us. Some days it is rainy. Some days it is tiny. Look how little the plant is that she planted, that yellow heart. But Tiny can grow. It grew into a great big tree. And grow. And grow. There are days it's a fence between me and the world. Days it's a whisper that can hardly be heard. There are days it is broken. But broken can mend, and a heart that is closed can be opened again. My heart is a shadow, a light, and a guide. Closed or open, I get to decide. There are a bunch of heart plants now. So this is a time when there's a lot of sadness because a lot of people are sick. And some people are dying from COVID-19, which is a virus. Oh, you might know somebody who's sick, or maybe you don't, but you can still be sad for people who are sick. Your heart can be wide open with your love for people. Your heart can be closed because it's too heavy. It's up to you and your heart. Just listen to your heart and see what it tells you today. Thank you. It is our custom when we come together each Sunday morning to light candles of joy and sorrow. And so since we're not together physically this morning, I'm going to light three candles. The first candle is a candle of hope for all those who are afflicted and affected by COVID-19. Hope for the world and all of the beings in it. A candle of strength for all those nurses and doctors and first responders and the janitors in the hospital rooms, the people who bring meals, for everyone who out of their love and concern for the world puts themselves at risk to serve others. We light this candle of strength. And finally, we light this third candle as a candle of joy that we can be together, that all over this country, people are managing to stay safe by social distancing, and yet still are able, thanks to technology, to come together. we enter this time of brief silence, I invite you to open your heart to the spirit of life, the spirit of love, the intangible mystery of the universe, infinite in ways we can never imagine. The spangled cosmos that surrounds us and cradles us in love. And now we will sing, Gathered Here in the Mystery of the Hour. Has ground to a halt, the work of the church goes on. We welcome your support, both in the time you give and in the financial resources. If you have bill pay set up with your bank, you can just add Beverly Unitarian Church as a bill to be paid online, or you can always send a check to the office. This is the second Sunday of the month, so we're encouraging you to go to the website of the UUSC, the Unitarian Universalist Service Committee, and use their donate button. They do much good in the world, and they deserve our support. We are grateful for all your support, and please join in saying our offertory words. And we are this church. We are its hands, its heart, its voice. Together we share the wealth of this community and sustain it with our gifts. Our reading this morning is from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 16. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb saying, "Who will roll away the stone from the entrance to the tomb?" They looked up and saw that the stone had already been rolled back, and on the right they saw a young man. They were alarmed, but the man said to them, "Why did you seek the living among the dead?" So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing, for they were afraid. So who is it that came to the tomb, and why did they come? In the Gospel according to Mark, which was the first of the four Gospels written, and it was written about the year 70 of the Common Era, right about the time the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed by the Romans. Three women went to the tomb where the crucified Jesus had been laid. Tombs in Israel at that time were dug into the side of the hill, and the opening was blocked with a large stone. The three women were Mary Magdalene, married the mother of James and Salome. And they went to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body with spices and oils. They were worried about how they would roll the heavy stone away from the entrance to the tomb so that they could enter. But when they got to the tomb, imagine their consternation when they found the tomb empty. Jesus' body gone, and some strange young man sitting in the tomb. Could he be an angel? We just don't know. Certainly the woman didn't identify him as such. The strange young man says, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." The women were terrified and amazed, and they didn't tell Jesus' disciples that the body was missing or pass on the strange young man's message, for they were afraid. And that's the end of the Easter story in the Gospel according to Mark, an inexplicably empty tomb. Later scribes couldn't bear the implications of an unexplained empty tomb, so they added stories like the ones found in the other later Gospels about Jesus having been risen from the dead and his followers seeing him alive again. For much of the Christian world, starting with Paul, whose epistles represent the earliest writings in the Christian scriptures, the thing about Jesus is that he was crucified, dead, and buried, and then rose from the dead on Easter morning, having overcome the power of death. There are other Christians, though, for whom the thing about Jesus is his life and what he taught by word and example. He was a Jewish mystic whose experience of God and God's love were the foundation of his ministry. He ministered to poor peasants, many of whom had lost their land under the heavy taxation from both the temple in Jerusalem and the Roman Empire. Jesus was a Jewish prophet, preaching in the tradition of the prophets of old about distributive justice, contrasting the kingdom of God, organized around love and justice, to the kingdom of Caesar, organized around domination and forced tribute to Rome. In Luke's gospel, Jesus starts his public activity by speaking in the synagogue, citing the prophet Isaiah, chapter 61 and 58. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. The Spirit of the Lord has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Jesus' ministry was based around healing, casting out demons, curing lepers, giving sight to the blind. It was based upon table fellowship with those who were ritually unclean. The thing about Jesus during his lifetime was that he preached and modeled an inspiring vision of the kingdom of God and shared God's passion for distributive justice. His mission was about the character of God, the way of centering in God, and the kingdom of God. His message was, "Be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate." Luke chapter 6, verse 36. Historically, we have a pretty good idea about why Jesus was tortured and crucified. It was a death that the Romans reserved for rebels against imperial domination. In the song from Jesus Christ Superstar that Greg sang earlier, Pontius Pilate says, "Tell this rabble to be quiet. We anticipate a riot. This common crowd is much too loud. Tell the mob who sing your song that they are fools and they are wrong. They are a curse. They should disperse." Both the Romans and the high priests who collaborated with the Romans had reason to fear a charismatic Jewish leader, drawing crowds in Jerusalem to add to the hundreds who had followed him from Galilee, and preaching God's kingdom that would replace the Roman emperor's oppression. It was Passover, the celebration of God's freeing of the Jews from Egyptian oppression. Jerusalem was a tinderbox waiting for the fuse to be lit, and Jesus was holding the torch. Pontius Pilate couldn't take the risk. We know that in his time as consul, Pontius Pilate had thousands and thousands of Jews crucified for the crime of rebelling against the Romans. Jesus was just one more. But from a theological point of view, why did Jesus have to die? While Mark leaves the question unexplored by ending with the empty tomb, other gospels suggest a viewpoint held by most Christians today. Jesus was a substitute for the punishment that should have befallen us. He was a substitutionary sacrifice so that we could be forgiven our sins, and he paid the ransom to set us free. The Gospel according to John, chapter 3, verse 16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." To me, that sounds like child abuse. Any explanation that suggests that God wanted Jesus to be tortured and to die an agonizing death on a cross, to my ears, makes God sound barbaric and not worthy of our worship. Faustus Socinus was a Unitarian theologian in the 1500s. He was the theological leader of the Polish Brethren, a Unitarian group that came into being at the same time as the Unitarians in Transylvania did. And in Transylvania, they were under the leadership of David Francis. The king of Poland in Transylvania was John Sigismund, who, unique among kingdoms in Europe, followed a policy of religious freedom. Faustus Socinus was from Italy, but he got in trouble with the Inquisition there and ended up in Poland, where he was safe. He maintained that the dogma of substitutionary sacrifice was against reason and against a sense of justice. He felt that the importance of Jesus' death was that it demonstrated the importance of remaining committed to fulfilling God's commands, no matter what the consequences are. He saw Jesus as being completely human, rejecting the Trinitarian view of Jesus as being both wholly human and wholly divine at the same time. And he rejected it because he couldn't find any basis in the scriptures for it. He thought the importance of the resurrection was that it confirmed Jesus' teachings. The man who taught me the Hebrew scriptures recounted being with a Jewish colleague in Jerusalem when the topic of Jesus' resurrection came up. His colleague said to him that no Jew would be surprised that Jesus was resurrected. It happened to other people in the Jewish scriptures. His colleague said to him, that the Jews, though, would be surprised that Christians made such a big thing about it. Marcus Borg, a prominent Jesus scholar and leading member of the Jesus Seminar, proposes looking at Jesus' life as a parable. With a parable, you're not concerned with whether it's factual or not. It doesn't really matter if there really was a good Samaritan or a prodigal son. The truth these familiar parables convey is not dependent on whether the stories are factually true. In the same way, it doesn't really matter if the story of Jesus' resurrection is factually true. What matters is that he gave his life as part of his ministry of love and justice, and that commitment is glorious and worthy of celebration. My New Testament professor at Vancouver School of Theology was also a member of the Jesus Seminar. His name is Lloyd Gaston, and he retired at the end of the semester I studied with him. The truth is that if he and I had both been 20 years younger, I would have done a PhD in New Testament studies under him. That's how interesting he made it. He made it so exciting to find the historical meanings of Jesus' teachings. He was the last graduate student of Karl Barth, who was a prominent German theologian in the 20th century. Barth is famous as the founder of neo-orthodoxy in Christianity. And by neo-orthodoxy, what he means is that it's worse than committing murder to try to have a religious experience of God. That the only way to know God is through the scripture and through the authority of the church. When I went to Duke Divinity School, it was basically a neo-orthodox seminary. Since the only thing I had in common with these people was my experience of God, that kind of cut the ground out from under my feet. The joke used to be at the seminary, if a window in a classroom was open, quick, close the window, the Holy Spirit might get in. Lloyd, when I knew him, had come a long way from neo-orthodoxy. In his retirement speech, he cautioned us about ever saying anything that implied that God caused Jesus' crucifixion and death. He said that he had come to believe that God had nothing to do with Jesus' death. There is a Jewish belief that in every generation, there are 37 righteous Jewish men. Lloyd believed that Jesus was one of the 37 in his generation. And then when Pontius Pilate had him crucified, God decided that since Jesus was dead anyway, God would use his death for higher purposes. There's a story in the Hebrew scriptures about Joseph, whose brothers were jealous of him, cast him into a pit, and then sold him to slave traders, who carried him to Egypt and sold him into slavery. Eventually, Joseph ends up in charge of storing grain to get ready for a huge famine, and his brothers show up in Egypt looking for food. They're shown into Joseph's palace, but they don't recognize him. He recognizes them, though, and he greets them joyfully. They say to you, "But we did evil to you. Are you not angry with us?" And Joseph answers, "What men meant for evil, God used for good." So it is with Jesus. What men meant for evil, God used for good. I've said it before, but it's still true. I am firmly planted in the Judeo-Christian tradition. I am not a traditional Christian, but I am a follower of Jesus. I don't have much use for the religion about Jesus, but I choose to live my life on the basis of the religion of Jesus. The thing about Jesus is that he matters. He's mattered for 2,000 years. Today he matters to me. He matters to Western civilization. His message of love and justice matters to the future of the world. There was a time in our denomination when Unitarian Universalist Christians felt marginalized and discriminated against. I hope we're past that now. We've been moving for a couple of decades from being a humanist movement to being a pluralist movement, one where people from every life-affirming faith or lack of faith is welcome. I thank you for welcoming my reflections today, and I'm grateful that all of me is welcome here. Amen. Ashe. Blessed be. Please join in singing, Jesus Christ is risen today.
Jesus Christ is risen today, alleluia. Earth and heaven in chorus say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, redeeming work is done, alleluia. Part the fight, the battle won, alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise, alleluia. Christ has opened paradise, strong in voices sing, alleluia. Where of death is now I steal, alleluia. As he died his truth to save, alleluia. Where thy victory
for extinguishing the chalice together. May faith in the spirit of life and hope for the community of earth be ours now and in all the days to come. As swimmers dare to lie face to the sky and water bears them, as hawks rest upon air and air sustains them, so would I learn to attain free fall and float into Creator Spirit's deep embrace, knowing no effort earns that all-surrounding grace.
The thunder and lightning gave voice to the night. The little lame child cried alone in the fright. Hush, little baby, a story I will tell. of love that has vanquished the powers of hell. Hallelujah, the great storm is over. Lift up your wings and fly. Hallelujah, the great storm is over. Lift up your wings and fly. A sweetness in the air and justice on the wind. A laughter in the house where the mourners have been. The deaf shall have music, the blind have new eyes. The standards of death taken down by surprise. Hallelujah, the great storm is over. Lift up your wings and fly. Hallelujah, the great storm is over. Lift up your wings and fly. Release for the captives and end to the wars. New streams in the desert, new hopes for the poor. The little lame children will dance as they sing and play with the bears and the lions in spring. The great storm is over. Lift up your wings and fly. Oh, hallelujah. The great storm is over. Lift up your wings and fly. So hush, little baby, let go of your fears. Lord loves his own, and your mother is here. The child fell asleep as the lantern did burn. The mother sang on till the bridegroom's return. So hallelujah, the great storm's over. Lift up your wings. Storms over, lift up your wings and fly.